Okay, let's go ahead and get ourselves started. So welcome back for session 17 of 120B T20B. Today we're going to continue talking about your building projects, and specifically we're looking at HVAC systems. We're going to look at a couple of different aspects. We're going to look at ducts a little bit and kind of tap into some of Gustavo's knowledge in terms of thinking about how ducts are sized and thinking about how we think about sizing them, and we do it in some other tools, and how that actually shows up in the building modeling tools within Revit. We're also going to take a little look at CFD analysis, so computational fluid dynamics, and how we can think about air flows and temperature flows and think about how that affects radiant floors, or even thinking about where we place different air terminals and how the air mixes in a space. So it's all kind of quite interesting and advanced stuff. We're also going to go through and just kind of continue kind of diving into just really getting going with the plumbing system side of things. Thinking about how the fresh water, both the hot and the cold, as well as the sanitary water that you're carrying away, gets modeled. And ultimately, we keep track of all that. And we're doing just a little bit more on the duct and CFD stuff. Let me get a sense of where you guys are in your process, because we're sort of crossing that boundary, kind of moving away from HVAC into plumbing. But I think people are in different points. A lot of people are sort of in the middle of putting ducts and terminals and things like that in there. You know, I'm going to start just making the transition here. Okay, in terms of the integrative design project, let's talk about what you guys are doing there and really where we are in the process. Because I realize we're a little out of sync with what it sort of says in the Canvas site right now. At a high level, we've been marching along, kind of doing some initial design. We did some structural framing, started talking about the structural analysis. This next check-in, where you should really be for this coming week when you meet with either Angad or Alana or myself, is kind of have a pretty good sense of what your HVAC system looks like. Again, for bigger buildings, you may be modeling a portion of it as opposed to the entire building, but come through and at least have your strategy and your general location of where the terminals are going to be, where the air handler is going to be. Don't worry if maybe everything doesn't precisely connect yet. I think a lot of you have found that as we connect everything, there's little parts which are, you know, not quite connecting. It's a little bit hard to make the geometry work sometimes. So, I'd say don't sweat that so much. We can always work through those little things. As long as you have the overall strategy, you know, you're in pretty good shape. This coming week, it's really time to start moving into the plumbing systems and get that within your model so that you at least understand where the sanitary lines and the freshwater lines are going to be. Okay, and you know, we're just sort of heading that way. Now, we're getting really close to the end of the quarter, so people are starting to wonder, well, how does this all wrap up? And it's kind of a tough one to sort of even give a definitive answer to, because we're all on these very different journeys. People are working on different buildings. They have different things that are their specific interests that they're quite keen on exploring in more detail. At some level, all your different endpoints are going to be different, because they're just different buildings. They're different things that you were interested in exploring. Now, that's kind of A-OK. In terms of what your final model should be, it's kind of a little bit different for everybody. It's really much more about this journey you've been on and what you've been doing within the models than the end point. But what I'm going to sort of recommend that we're going to do, or say that there are a couple discrete points we want you to be ready for. One is next Thursday, so on the 10th, okay, think about having a 15-minute period to really feature a few highlights. Okay, not your entire model, because there's really, you know, you can have an hour spending all the time talking about your analysis and planning and your detail that went into the modeling. So really almost think about it in terms of 2 to 3 things that you really loved about your building, that was really kind of a unique aspect where you spent some time modeling it, maybe came up with a surprising result or particularly challenged with doing something. But don't think about this being exhaustive. Think about it just really being a few highlights of your building. Okay, because we've sort of heard little snippets about each other's buildings, but most people aren't all that familiar with each other's. If you go back to the design journals, you can look at some of the other ones. But think about if you had 15 minutes to share something about your building. Again, not an exhaustive summary of all 12 aspects of the building. It's really more just a few things. How would you go ahead and use that? Okay, and I'll differentiate that from, I'll put out some the links to the past examples of presentations I've done in the past. But I would sort of say, as opposed to thinking about making a comprehensive presentation, where in the past we all had the same project, so people talked about all the aspects and how they covered it. Since your projects are so unique, it's almost like your presentations are going to be a little bit unique. So if you were really all about the energy systems and modeling those, talk about that. If you had a really interesting structural system, talk about that. If you had some specific challenges, because in terms of working with a historical character, that made some interesting, you know, trade-offs that you had to sort of build in and kind of it limited you in some way, talk about that. Just, yeah. So think about 2 to 3 things you could talk about it. Okay, we'll do that next Thursday in class. Okay, you'll still go ahead and post your design journals and all that kind of stuff. Put that out there. If you haven't been posting for a while, please go ahead and put something in there. But in the end, here's what you're gonna do. By the end of all this, and even next Thursday may or may not be the end for you, it just kind of depends on how you are in your process. If you are not quite done and it is just sort of close to what you have in mind, that is super, present that. Towards the end, what you want to do is you want to post a final design blog entry, which is like your wrap-up that kind of pulls it all together. And when you do that, it's really going to be depending on sort of what you want to have as your schedule. Some people will finish that up during the end of dead week, and that's A-okay. You know, super, get it done, be done with it, don't have a bad finals week. If you want to sort of extend that into finals week because you still have a few things you want to do with the project to kind of nail some things down, feel free to do that. That's kind of everyone, you all have an extension if you want it to go into finals week to finish that up. Really, my final deadline is actually, it's the Tuesday after finals week where we have to have everything graded and ultimately submit a grade for the class. But see if you can get it finished up either during the last week or during finals week. Get that posted and go ahead and use the extra time not to think about necessarily doing more and more that you didn't get done, but kind of to wrap up what you have. And even if you don't have everything done about the project and all the systems fully mapped out, that's okay. You know, put them on your list of things you would love to explore over spring break or in a future quarter or something like that. But don't go beating yourself up because some of the projects people have taken on are really quite large and complicated. And yeah, you may not have enough time between now and even the end of finals week to sort of fully do all the systems in every building. Okay, so that's A-okay. It's really more about, I'd rather you sort of do a good job with the systems that you do finish up as opposed to just stretching yourself too thin. So think about narrowing the scope and kind of coming on down. But let's pause there for a second, and get a sense of where people are relative to that. Does that sort of make sense to you as you're thinking about your own project and trying to process what you're finishing up? Do you sort of get a sense of what you're going to do over the next 2 weeks? Or is it, I'm seeing several head shakes. I'm not quite sure I'm seeing, okay, yes. Christine, you have a sense of what you're up to? Okay, good. Ms. Britt? Yeah. Okay, super. If you have questions, ask us as you're meeting this week. Yeah, we could even kind of come up. It'd be great as part of the meeting this week to come up with your action plan for what's really the next 2 weeks and when to close this. Because the danger of all these building modeling classes, as many as you discovered in A, is there's no end. You could spend the next 12 weeks full time just doing this project and you still wouldn't be done. So you have to sort of just decide this is the scope of what we're going to do and kind of cut it off. Okay. That's it for the design project. Let's go ahead and return to the topic of HVAC systems just to finish up a couple of topics that would be nice just to sort of kind of put a wrapper on. One is the whole issue of duct sizing. The other is this whole issue of CFD analysis. So duct sizing is something that all air-based systems get involved with and how we compute the loads. CFD analysis is something that's particularly relevant if you're doing radiant systems. But even for air-based systems, it's useful to sort of think about how the air is flowing through the space and mixing and really what the level of comfort is that you have. So for duct sizing, the big things that we sort of need to think about is that really, ultimately, the ducts are sized based on the notion of there's some amount of required flow. And within that required flow, it could really be made up of like two different components. There's a certain amount which is being needed for ventilation. Okay, so we have to provide a certain amount of fresh air just to kind of keep it to be a healthy space, and that is usually a mix of kind of some recycled as well as some fresh air. Okay, we also have a certain amount of airflow that may be required for heating and cooling. So just based upon the amount of heating and cooling that's required, based on the occupancy, the thermal properties of the room, the operating schedule, we can compute a certain amount of flow that's required to go through and supply that room. And The combination of those two things ultimately figures out how much flow we need to bring on in. I always say that it's sort of, you take the higher one, whether it's the heating and cooling load or the ventilation load, that's going to ultimately determine how much flow we need. Because if we bring in more air than is required for ventilation, that's okay. If we bring in more ventilation air than was required for heating and cooling, that's okay. So it's really the whatever the greater of those two is. And based on those required flows, we go through and figure out a duct size. Okay, so there's different sort of methods of dealing with this. Like I often use, I call it our sizing methods. The method of thinking about velocity sort of being the restricting criteria. Okay, for velocity, what we're gonna do is say there's a certain amount of flow going through there. We only want the speed to go through at a maximum level. If it gets to be too fast, we tend to have problems with the ducts being noisy or being static energy or static electricity being generated in the ducts. So we can size them based on velocity. But some other people base them on friction. So like Gustavo, do you have any guidance for us in terms of just thinking about sizing methods, or like as you were doing it in your tutorial, like did you use both those methods, or how did you actually sort of approach sizing it once you computed sort of a certain amount of CFM?
It was based on velocity.
Okay, great. So super. That seems to be the way, that's the easiest for me to understand. Okay, so we're gonna get some required CFM, we're gonna size them based on that. Let's go ahead and show you how that all sort of plays out in Revit, just as a compliment. I know Gustavo gave a tutorial for the 256 class that kind of talked about how to do all this using spreadsheet methods. And it is a perfectly valid way to do that, but we can also do this. Just, you know, a lot of the same sort of calculations are all buried in Revit. So you can use that too. And to do this, what I'm gonna do is go back to, I'm gonna find where I left it. I think I left it in session, let's see if it's in 16. There it is. Import model with spaces defined. If you go back to 16 and open up that Revit model, let's just go ahead and take a look at a real, that real simple building and where that information lives here. So if I start out just looking at this building in 3D, okay, here's this little building. It's not really all that interesting. We can look at it in terms of its floor plans. You sort of see it has several different like spaces that are all sort of set up. Basically, within all these different rooms, there are some different spaces that are defined. And these spaces are really defined as just going from the floor all the way up to the roof level. Each of these different spaces has an occupancy associated with it, and that occupancy ultimately is going to say a lot about really what the loads are on that room. So in here, we could even go through and go to the space schedule. You'll see I actually have four different spaces in here. I have four different classrooms, northwest, northeast, southwest, southeast. A certain square footage. They all have a building occupancy, which is for a school or classroom, so around 43 square feet and around 21 people in each of those different rooms. We also have a corridor. I called that out just a little bit differently. It has a higher area per person, so there's just fewer people in there. And as we think about the loads, that's just going to be important because all those people and the fresh air requirements associated with those people kind of kick into the notion of really how much ventilation area we need. Okay. All those people are actually generating heat too, so that's contributing to the cooling load. So more people, more ventilation, but also more cooling necessary because we all put off quite a bit of heat. So the other thing that sort of factors into this is the thermal properties of the room. So if, for example, I choose the walls that are in the background here, we got the floor there. Let me go do it in 3D because it may be easier time getting it that way. You'll see I have a wall there. That wall is made of a certain material. It has an R value associated with it. The roof has an R value. We've associated thermal properties. So somehow the combination of the people, the operating hours, the outside temperature, and these R values all work together to go through and figure out just how much heating or cooling is necessary. Now, in terms of like really getting sort of quite specific about this, there are some tools right within Revit that help us model it very accurately, the same way you would in those spreadsheet models that you're used to using. So for example, within the whole notion of computing the heating and cooling loads, there's this notion of spaces. Each space belongs to a zone, and the way in Revit it works is the thermal characteristics of the zone actually determine, you know, what's happening with the heating and cooling system and the loads. So if I come to this thing that says heating and cooling loads, I can sort of see there's my different spaces right now. Right now I'm sort of estimating it as just a VAV system. Okay, I have a building construction type. I am using the thermal properties as opposed to the overrides of the building. Okay, it's a school or university located in Boston, so that'll give us the weather profile, the heating or cooling. Actually, we should try this. I've never tried it here. If I go to Moscow, let's see if that works. Moscow, Ohio, that doesn't look sound right. Now, what's the correct way to say that? Is it not, is it Russia, or do you say USSR? Russia. Okay, beautiful. That looks like it. Okay, we'll use your weather profile instead. Okay, and what's it like there? Is it very cold? I think it's been very, very cold in the winter.
Rather cold, yeah.
How about in the summertime?
Summertime it's rather cold.
It's summer, okay.
In summer, but in winter it's about minus 20 Celsius.
Really? Yikes. For our friends from Southeast Asia, this is like, they're going, wow. It's like, that sounds very cold. Okay. No worries. So we'll go through and use the weather profile there. In terms of thinking about the heating and cooling and how the system gets carried out in some detail, you'll see all these spaces right now are just in some default zone. The notion of really the heating information and the cooling information, these two numbers right in here, this is the temperature of the air that's actually being introduced by the heating and cooling system. So under heating information, you'll see what's happening is we have the heating set point is 70, the heating air temperature is coming from the furnace, coming from the heater at 90. Okay, we could even say whether there's humidification control, because we're going to lose some energy in terms of doing that. But there's all these parameters which ultimately determine, you know, how much air needs to flow. If we, for example, lowered the heating air temperature to like 80, it would be not as hot coming out of the ducts, so we'd probably have to have more air to kind of deliver the same equivalent kind of amount of heat. Same thing over here on the cooling side. We have this whole issue of the cooling set point and the cooling air temperature. You can make a huge impact on your building if you change these set points. There's that thing, if you change the thermostat just a few degrees, and we allowed that it doesn't have to stay 74, but it could actually get up to 76 or 78. The air conditioning wouldn't kick on nearly as much, so it would use much less energy. The cooling air temperature, that's coming from the chiller. And again, to have it be this cold means a lot of energy is going into the chilling of the air, but there's probably less of the air. So it's kind of this funny trade-off between energy you'd introduce and then how much you actually come back and use. This whole air notion down here, this is outdoor air information. This gets into the amount of outdoor air you need or air changes per hour. So if we wanted to go through and say that a certain amount has to come from the outdoor, that means it's going to be introduced and mixed with the air coming from the heater or cooler. It's not, there's a certain percentage that won't be recycled. Okay, it'll come at the outdoor temperature as opposed to a recycled temperature. So it may take a little more work or a little more energy to get it to the right thing. So, Gustavo, do you have any sort of recommendation on outdoor air per person? I know there's a whole table we could look up to sort of come up with an average, but do you have any sort of rough guidance on that one?
15 CFM.
About 15 CFM per person?
Yep.
Okay, excellent. Okay, and that's based on occupancy and all those different things. We could look that up. Super. So we have all that information. We are ready to go through and run our ASHRAE calculations. So when you went through and were doing it in your tutorial, did you look up a series of tables, or was that all just built into lookups within Excel, or how did it actually go through and compute the numbers?
Tables for to calculate loads. Mm-hmm. Looked at tables, and then we summed the loads.
Beautiful. Okay, that's all done in Excel.
Yep.
Excellent. Okay. The same sort of calculations are going on in the background here. If I just, again, go to that report and I run the report, let's come back over here, and I say calculate, using our new improved Moscow temperature profile, we'll calculate. and it's gone through and it's done. These are all just the ASHRAE calculations. So for this, we have a certain amount of square footage. We have the kind of peak cooling load. We have the peak heating load, okay, for this building, about 412 BTUs. Okay. And then as we go through and think about every individual space, so it's all one zone right now. I didn't really break it into multiple zones. But for every space, for example, the Northwest classroom, you can sort of see the area of the room. We can see the sensible heat gain per person, the infiltration flow, the peak cooling load, the peak heating load. Okay. And we have the peak heating airflow and the peak cooling. Peak cooling airflow right there. So of these, it looks like I have a cooling airflow of about 2564, a heating airflow of about 1623 or something like that. Okay. So I would go through and try to size my ducts. I would probably go for the peak cooling so that I have enough cool air there. It'll be a little oversized for the winter, but of around 2564, and that'll be the amount of ductwork I'll need. Okay, so let's come on back. In each of the different zones, it's going to do something very similar. So the peak heating, the peak cooling. You could also see a little bit down in here in terms of the different seasons, like on the cooling side, what is it that contributes so much to the cooling load? Some of it's going through the roof, some of it's going through the window. You can sort of see what the percentages are out here. Even the people over here, you can see that the people are actually contributing 12% of the heat that has to be cooled. And we have on the heating side, really most of it's going out through the roof, some of it's going out through the windows. So overall, I'd say if I was trying to improve my performance, I'd be looking at the roof and the thermal properties there to see if there was some way we could go through and reduce some of what's going through the roof. But what we're going to look at are these numbers, because those numbers are ultimately going to determine how much we need to go through and supply. So when we go through and go back to the spaces, you'll see that in every space now, it actually computes what's considered the calculated supply. Okay. So based on that, if we need to go through and provide, we have the return airflow, we have the other, it looks like 2,900 CFM. Okay. We can now go through and either use that, the calculated. Right now, we're specifying the same as the calculated. Okay. But we could change that. And for return airflow, we could either use the calculated, the specified, or we could actually put in actual like ducts. But what we'll do is we'll take this number, divide it through by some reasonable amount to have radiating from each of the different terminals. So for example, if it was 500 each, we'd need 6 different supply terminals to go through and provide that. Okay. So the numbers, what I really want to show out of all of this is that the numbers come from the same place. It's really the same tables, whether you do it in Excel or you really use it on Revit to do it. It all sort of works out to actually use the same thing. So what happens now is if I've gone through and put that together, and now I go through and try to connect some different ducts and terminals in here. Oh, let me go ahead. Well, we'll just do it this way. I need some supply diffusers. Oh, where am I going to put them? I'm going to put them at 8 feet off the floor. They're each 500, so I'm going to need 6 of these. I'll just line them up over here. I know I'm in 2 different rooms right now, but I just want to get those in there. So you can see it as a starting point. Okay, for the duct, we'll put the duct in place. Again, we usually end up putting a starting point duct in there just to get us going. And now what we'll do is go through and connect those individual terminals to it. So I'll say, let's get that one over there, and I'll connect it in to that one. That's interesting. Oh, let's kind of just check the heights and stuff like that. Whenever it gives me the no auto route is found, I just got to check the geometry. About 8 feet off the floor, what do I have over here? About 8'4", that's a little too close. It's not going to be able to make the bends. So I'm going to pull that up a little higher. Let's try that again. Okay, that's looking pretty good. For these other ones, what I'm going to do is pull that through. Cancel that. Super. And for the final piece, we'll just go through and put a little flexi duct in there to connect the ends of these terminals back in to the pipe. Again, I like doing that just because it gives you that little bit of geometric flexibility. Super. Here we are. Don't worry about the fact that the flexi duct is not showing in the 3D model. Generally, if it's a very tight connection, it just doesn't draw it. It is there. It actually is considered to be there. So at this point, we can take a look at this whole series as being a system. See if I can turn on the system inspector and sort of see what's going on. You can sort of see there's a little bit of air flowing to each of these, 500 to that one, 1,000, 1,500, 2,500. See, I might have a funny connection in there somewhere. There's 2,500. That one's 3,000 over there. So at this point, I can say I want to do the duct sizing. And the way that works is, since you have the flow, you can say duct and pipe sizing, and again, choose what your maximum velocity that you want is. And if I have 500 CFM and I want 1,000 feet per minute, then I need basically provide half of a foot of like a cross-sectional area to go ahead and deliver that. But if I use that formula, they're going to get bigger and bigger. If I need 2,500, I need basically 2.5 feet of cross-sectional area of duct to go ahead and provide that. So Gustavo, for you, like if you're using velocity, like what sort of velocity do you use as your cap? That would actually be much more lenient for us. 1,000, you're going to find out, really makes these ducts very big. Let's try it this way first. I'll do 1,000 first. You're going to find that all the little ducts don't get very much bigger. But see how it continues to step on up. There's a little funniness going on in here. Like, that isn't correct right now, that little sort of pinch point and stuff like that. What I sometimes have to do is basically take out that, reconnect them, and then reconnect that back in. Because what's happening in here is just it sized them pretty restrictively and, you know, made it really much bigger than the existing connection. So the connection didn't size back up. Either that, or you can do this. If you know that, for example, this is a 17 by 17. Okay, you can come over here and say that that's going to be 17 by 17. Okay, and sort of just manually tweak them. You never want pinch points. It's always, you're pretty much, as you go upstream, it's going to get bigger and bigger. Same thing here, this is 19 by 19. So for that junction, I know that I don't want it to be any smaller than that. So we can go through and size it on up, and that sort of works, although you certainly see how big these things get very quickly. But that's at the 1,000 FPM. Let's go ahead and change it to the higher level, sort of see what a difference that makes. So if instead of this, I said duct and pipe sizing, and we use the 2,500, pop in there, say okay. I expect these will be much smaller. Ah, that's looking a little more reasonable. So if you're willing to live with a 2,500 FPM, this is not 19 by 19 or 17 by 17, it's 11 by 11. This is 12 by 12. What's this one here? I think I still need to make that one a little bit bigger. 14 by 14. So I'll still make that bigger. So, Mr. Gustavo, don't mean to pick on you, but are there any trade-offs in terms of, like, you know, as we go from, like, allowing a higher velocity through there, you know, are there some trade-offs to the whole thing? Or, like, when you, what's the difference if I sort of start allowing more and more velocity going through?
Just noise? Another thing that I saw from the table was that for the circular ducts, it allowed a higher velocity.
Yeah, they're very efficient in terms of, like, you know, the amount of surface area and the amount of energy going through them. Okay, that makes sense. So just in terms of sizing, if the 1,000 is really kind of pinching you and your ducts are getting so incredibly large that you can't fit them anywhere, consider raising the size, and there's a trade-off. Okay, and like most things, you know, there's no right answer. It's kind of a trade-off between how big you can allow those to be, because if those are starting to get to be 30 by 30 inches or 40 by 40 inches, they're quite huge. You know, that's probably larger than you want. So you may need to relax the requirement of, like, what the FBM limit is. Okay, let's just pause there for a second. I just wanted to do that in relationship to kind of what Gustavo done, because I think it's sort of interesting to kind of look at the two parallel with each other. It's that you couldn't go through and do this all in Excel. In other ways, Revit's a very good calculator. So it's not bad to let it do the calculations. You just have to understand what rules it's using inside the black box. And sometimes the hardest part is just that the rules are sort of buried between two or three different dialog boxes, so it's hard to figure out where the hole is. Yes, Mr. Henry.
Is there a trade-off in energy performance?
In terms of bigger versus smaller?
In terms of speed, size,
and good. Very good question. I think that will happen as I make those ducts smaller, okay, and kind of compress the air. I think it uses more energy to move the air, doesn't it?
I think so.
So we have a more of an energy loss in terms of doing that. So the overall system's probably consuming more energy to that. The temperature hopefully will still be the same in terms of what we're delivering. I think it's just the overall efficiency of the system. Yeah, it basically you're pushing against. You have to try and squeeze the air through a smaller aperture. Although it's kind of interesting. In theory, does it all work out about the same with the velocity, or do you sort of pick up more of an energy loss because of the friction? And I don't know right offhand. It's one of those. We should ask Eric about that.
Yeah, he touched on that a little bit. It's like, so you can be energy efficient on like the duct, on the ducts or on the fan, but you gotta find like a sweet spot.
Okay, between those two.
Yeah.
That actually makes perfect sense. It's all kind of a question of sort of balancing the overall system as opposed to like optimizing this one aspect of it. Okay, cool. Very good. Let us then kind of look at another issue. The last issue I wanna kind of take a look at in terms of HVAC before we move on to plumbing isn't the duct sizing, but it's thinking about these radiant systems and just the whole notion of really how heat is moving around. And to do that, I want to introduce you to a tool called CFD analysis, which is very useful for doing this. I only have this installed on my machine, but we can certainly have you install it on your machines if you want to. But again, don't feel like if you're obligated to. I'll talk about the case where it really makes perfect sense to do this. Like, for mini rooms like this, well, we'll talk about sort of how the heat flows in a room like this and how you place the different ducts, show you what the effect of that is. You know, it may not be necessary in a kind of a fairly standard layout. If any of you have a very big open exhibit hall or a huge atrium or something like that, it may make more sense to kind of think about this, because the whole issue of mixing of air in a very large space gets to be very complex. And as you're trying to think about where to put in the air and really how it fills the entire space, you know, the effects are kind of subtle. So we could actually use a little analysis to figure out what the best location for the terminals are and how to orient them. Okay? But we'll start by showing you sort of a really simple example. That is, at some level, what we're going to do is very similar to finite element analysis. We're going to go ahead and just really mesh an entire space. We're going to think about air as being the fluid, and we can simulate the temperature, the pressure, the velocity, the flow of the air moving through it. We're just going to go through and break it up to a series of discrete mesh elements, and then based on boundary conditions and sort of things we're introducing to the space, think about really how the balance of the air is moving on through. So we can look at it in a number of different contexts. A simple room we can look at. I'd love to go ahead and look at it in terms of an exhibit hall or really even a thermal chimney. When we talk about how we want to have an atrium and have the air kind of pulled out through the top of the chimney, through the top of, you know, if we really want to see if that works or not, this is the way to do it. We sort of model the air and sort of say, if you have the openings on the outside, can you pull it forward? But we're today going to look at a simple room. If anyone wants to dig into this for a bigger space, we can look at exhibit hall or one of these other ones, but we can look at that individually too and give you guidance about where to look at that. But here's how we basically approach the problem. You're going to basically model your elements in Revit. And that part's actually not too bad. We're going to go ahead and put walls and floors and roofs on there. We need to enclose the space. And then we're going to actually go through and model the air, which sounds kind of strange. Revit will actually do something for you where it'll auto-generate that now. So if we use the exporter, basically Revit will auto-generate the air. But we'll start with an example where we're actually kind of doing that as an explicit object. The idea is we're going to transfer that information to CFD. So there's like a little plug-in that if you install the CFD program, it actually launches an active model. We're going to assign some materials. We have to understand what all the material properties are. We're going to set up the boundary conditions, which are sort of the temperature differentials and where the air is introduced and at what temperature. And we're finally going to run a simulation. Okay. And let me just kind of show you what that looks like as a starting point. And then if anyone wants to dive into it, you can go ahead and use it. But I'll go show you sort of a simple example. Oops, bring that back up. So you can get a sense of this. Okay, this little model is really of a relatively simple room. Let me go ahead and see if I can orbit that and make it look a little bit better for you. What we're looking at, this is a very simple little volume. It's like a room. We have a desk that someone is sitting at. We have a person and a chair they're sitting on, sort of sitting in the room. Okay? And we have a couple of different sort of ways that air leaves or enters the room. So what's happening right now is, back up in here, at the top of the screen, so I can get out of that. So, okay, back up in here, we have actually different surfaces where we're going to introduce air, and it's going to blow out through a series of different terminals up near the ceiling. So warm or cold air is going to come out and blow into the ceiling. This part over here, over on the other side, let me kind of point to it, is the return. And what we're going to do there is say that really there's a certain amount of just like pressure, in this case with zero pressure on it, which will allow the air to leave. So what's going to happen is, in this surface over here, okay, we're going to go through and introduce air. It's going to have a certain flow rate, a certain CFM. It's going to have a certain temperature based on the temperature coming from the furnace or from the chiller. Okay? And then it's going to leave the room from this space over here. Okay? In this case, we have zero pressure there. We typically just leave it at zero pressure, so it sort of passively goes in there. The air has to go somewhere, so it goes into the return. You could actually introduce suction there, too, if you wanted to, if you really wanted to pull things out. But generally, just leaving it at zero pressure accomplishes what you want to do. Okay, now, so this is basically the room, and those are the sort of boundary conditions. The other boundary condition you have to sort of think about, though, is actually these wall surfaces all around the side. These wall surfaces have a certain number, like a characteristic to them too, where depending upon whether it is winter or summer, they'll have a temperature on the outside surface that's going to go through and try to affect the heating inside the room. Okay, so let me kind of go through and show you the summer scenario, and then we'll go from there. Okay. each of these different surfaces has some sort of material associated with it. So when you bring this in, what you start with is basically associating materials with different things. For example, the main volume, which is air, is assigned to a material called air, which is a fluid. It can go ahead and change. There's the walls as we go moving around to the sides. They all have both the wall and the roof are defined as being glass wool, so sort of like an insulative material. Okay. The human actually has his own material. So the human is, we have our own sort of specific heat and density and how heat moves through us. The wood, can be changed too. In this case, I define the desk as being wood. But the idea is that for any of these different sort of objects out here, let me even go ahead and change one because I sort of messed up when I first set it up myself. I'll say materials. See if I can grab the volume. Hang on, let's see if I have to hide this one first. I want to hide it. Deselect all. Don't use this every day. So let me try suppressing it. Nope, I'm not gonna do it right now. I'll just leave it at that. Okay, but basically we've assigned materials to all these different things because I don't want to spend too much time doing this. It's just sort of an ancient issue of the concept. We assign the materials, that's super. We go through and for every different sort of surface, which is at the boundary, we can go through and assign different characteristics, for example, to it. For example, this wall, which is out over here, you can go ahead and take a look at its properties. This has what's called a film coefficient associated with it. When warm air moves past the wall and starts to circulate, there's a certain coefficient for basically how efficiently that air sort of gets picked off as the convective air moves past it, how much heat actually gets carried by the air. And we're going to say that the outside temperature is currently 85 degrees. So this is like a summer cooling scenario. Outside it's 85 degrees Fahrenheit. Cancel that. We do that to all those different surfaces. We sort of set up a couple different surfaces. There's this surface which is right up here. That's the place where we're going through and introducing the heat. So that's going to have a pressure to it. Let's see what's going on. Actually, that has a flow to it. If I say it has a volume flow rate, it's, what's going on here? Why is it not showing that? Do it over there. Has a flow rate of 150 CFM. So that's actually fairly low. If I wanted to make that higher, I could change that number to be a higher steady state number. It also has a temperature associated with it. Okay, and since it's a cooling scenario, I'm going to introduce the air at 65 degrees. Okay, similarly, over here on this surface, which is the return. I'm going to go through and edit that and show you that it just has a pressure of zero. And we pretty much just set up the boundary conditions. And once we've set up these boundary conditions, what we do is we say, great, we're going to go through and solve this. Okay, we sort of choose the boundary where we want to start, whether it's from step zero or later on. Or if we want to continue an existing analysis for this one, let me go ahead and start there. I'm going to basically run it for another 20 iterations and show you what happens. So far, we've gotten that much. It's basically gone through and, for all the different things going on there, starting at the first iteration, some initial values, it's gone through and computed the velocities, the pressures, the temperatures, all those things are being reported, starting in iteration one. I've already run 80 iterations. What's happening is as we move through each iteration, things are normalizing. We're finding the steady state, using kind of a finite element method. So as we keep going, what's going to happen is these plots continue to move a little bit. you'll sort of see overall what tends to happen to the temperature in the room is the temperature actually started out fairly low, but it's sort of moving up on average. Because what's happening is, as all that cool air is exposed to all the warm air around the surfaces, or all the warm surfaces, that room is just sort of heating up over time. Okay, so let's let it run. What's happening over here in the big window is, that's actually showing to us right now what's considered an isosurface. So that is all the different points in space that are currently at the same temperature. Okay, and we'll look at that in just a second in terms of sliding through it and sort of seeing how the temperature actually flows through the room. But at a high level, what we're trying to do is just sort of see if cold air is coming in up here and it's releasing through, like that, through that opening, just basically how does that air mix through the room right now? That's crazy. It is insane. But let's show it's actually, even from that, can you tell what happens? What happens with cold air? Because like, it generally falls. Okay, so let's watch what's happening. We have the cold air. It's being introduced through these ducts right here. It's falling down, and our poor human over here is basically like sitting in the middle of like a torrent of cold air. Okay, which may or may not be a very good thing. This is exactly the condition that we talked about earlier, which makes me so uncomfortable in restaurants sometimes, where as the air comes down, even if it's not shooting down at me, just the fact that it's going to naturally try to fall means it's coming down, whether I want it to or not. And it's a question of how close it's going to come down to me. Okay, we're up to iteration 98. The more we go with this, the more we'll tend to just get a leveling effect. It'll just keep on getting a better and better result. Okay, 99. Let me go to 100. Okay, super. Hemi, yes?
So, what do you mean by iteration? Right? Is it, how does that relate to the time the thing is on?
What it's doing is, it's not related to time. What it is just trying to figure out what the steady state condition, and with most finite element methods, you sort of say, there's these boundary conditions and they're way off for each other, but we know somehow it has to normalize into some sort of equilibrium. So we come in a little from this side, we come from that side, then we run another iteration, we keep on coming closer and closer, and the more iterations you come, the more resolved the situation is, the more you have a true model of what's going on there. So, yeah, it's not really time-based. It's really more, this is sort of the steady state condition. It's just really, the more iterations, the finer our model of the steady, or the more accurate our model of the steady state condition is gonna be. Okay, so let's show you what this did. That's the convergence plot, that's kind of okay, but let's come back over here and show you what's happening here. To look at this, I tend to look at things in terms of things called isosurfaces. I'm gonna do the temperature isosurface, and let me show you sort of what happens. Oh, currently it's in Celsius. Let me go through and change that to Fahrenheit, just because that'll be a little easier for me to understand. Not so much for our guest, but you'll get this figured out. So we'll edit this. So here's what's going on. The colors are going to indicate where the temperature is. You might remember that temperature air is coming in at 65 degrees. So this is where the 65 degree air is. This is where the 67 degree air is. Notice what's happening. The air is starting to fall, but it's also heating up. And the reason it's heating up is it's sort of in a warm room. So even though you introduce it at 65, it doesn't stay at 65. It keeps on, it starts getting warmer. Right around here, right when it's coming down the back of our person, it's right around 68 degrees, which is better than being in 65 degrees, okay? But it's starting to come around the back. It hits the floor. Then it starts to pool up and go around. Then it starts filling the room. And there's always a zone of air that's pretty good. It's around 70 degrees in there. So, as long as I'm not under the vent, that's probably considered a fairly good room. If I keep on going further out here, you'll see the temperature is going up. That's where 72 degrees is, 74 degrees. That's pretty good. It's really not till you get to the walls where it starts to get to be much higher. And there is this point, if we go all the way out to the out, that'll be where the 85 is, that's the outside of the walls. But you'll see that in the walls, it makes a pretty big leap from the high 70s up to that 85, and that's happening in the insulation of the walls. So it's quite a good model for starting to understand this and trying to think about really where, how temperature sort of mixes in a room. So based on this, the idea is you might decide that as opposed to putting all that air right there, maybe what I would do would put, oh, five or six different terminals and not point them to the center. Maybe I should point them to the outside wall. Or maybe I should split it up so it doesn't come down as one big plume, but just to kind of distribute it so it comes through a little more evenly. So this is kind of the cooling scenario. The cooling scenario is air comes in and kind of shoots down. And that's why we tend to go through and have, oh, we'll have cooling at the top because it sort of mixes, the whole room gets cool. Okay. Let's try a different scenario though, just so you can sort of see it. We could take that very same geometry and we can switch over to a winter scenario. Okay, the winter scenario, let me kind of take a look at that. Let's make that kind of, transparent again so we can sort of see inside. In this scenario, we just changed it around a little bit. We said that for that upper surface, as opposed to, the outside walls, they're going to be at 45 degrees, okay, which is cool, but not necessarily freezing. Okay, the temperature that we're coming in at is 90 degrees. Okay, so we're bringing in warm air into a cool environment. And the way this one works, when you go through and play it all out, is, go back over here, I'll do the temperature again. Hang on, I'm still in Celsius. Let's edit this. Okay, the cold air, you might imagine, is right around the boundaries because the walls are cold. Okay, so in the walls, it's quite cold. We sort of have cold right there. We get into the room, and all of a sudden, the room starts heating up. It's still sort of cold around the edges, although we're just about to break through into the main room, okay? So now we're sort of in the 60s, which is sort of considered, tolerable. We basically see the warm air at the top of the room. We see here at the high level, there's the warm air coming in. Okay. But notice how it sort of pools at the ceiling. It takes a long time for the warm air to actually get down. In fact, notice where it does start creeping down. Where the warm air starts creeping down is when it starts getting colder around the edges because it hit the cold wall. It gets colder, so it starts flowing down as opposed to kind of staying at the top of the room. So as we keep on going, you see it's still around the outside. And it takes quite a while for it to fill in, okay, and get our guy in the middle here comfortable. He's still sitting around at a little bit less than 67 degrees. Okay, even though we're bringing in this fantastic 90 degree air, he's actually still relatively cool. And if it was even colder outside, we might have to adjust it even more. So again, we have to think about the mixing. To make this better, we might go ahead and have some heat being introduced at the bottom as opposed to at the top, so he sort of is exposed to more heat, it sort of goes past him. Which is why in a lot of homes and some buildings, we put the heating down on the floor, or we put the radiators down close to you, we put them down near you, so you get the advantage of the heat kind of hitting you before it all goes up to the ceiling. Okay. The last scenario though I want to show you in this, and there's like a lot of cool scenarios you can play with in this, is we'll do the radiant heating scenario. So let's assume for a second that what we did was go through and just adjust the boundaries. So in this case, what I'm going to do is really introduce very little heat at the top. I'm going to say this is primarily a condition where we're going to let the floor be hot and let the floor radiate up and do very little up here. Maybe we'll still have some coming in just because of the ventilation air. We need to have a little kind of healthy air coming through there. So in this scenario, again, we changed things around a little bit. What I did was I actually pulled this floor surface, which is down here at the bottom, okay, and floor that floor surface. I'm just basically giving it a 90 degree temperature. So yeah, where to go? It's the film coefficient. I'm gonna let the air convect across it. Why does that not look right? Volume flow, that's that. It's down here. 90 is still coming in at the top. It's the 82 degrees. So that bottom surface, we're going to let it go ahead and have a temperature of 82. At 82, you might think he's going to be pretty comfortable in here. It feels kind of toasty down by your feet and stuff like that. You get a little bit of warm air coming in up here, but that should come up. But let's sort of see how it actually plays out. So if I use this radiant system, okay, and I go through it again, solve, okay, saying that right now, actually, let me sort of see where I am in here right now. If I go to the results, how far did I go right now? I'm not sure. Let's see what the output bar is. Oh, I got 29 points. Okay, that's not quite as far as I want to be, so let me go ahead and continue to solve a little bit further. I'll keep going from 29. Let me give it, sort of another 10 iterations. That'll just sort of take it a little further and give me a little finer answer. You don't have to get all 100 points. You can sort of get your answer after 5 or 10 iterations, super. But the more iterations you go, the finer the result you're getting. Okay, so we'll just let that kind of cook. 29, 30. So any guesstimates about what's going to happen with this one? This is where we have a hot floor. Okay, so how do you think this? We got a little air flowing in from the top too, but basically the floor is hot. The walls are still cold though. That's kind of interesting. So if the floor is sort of universally hot or uniformly hot and the walls are cold, yeah, how do you think it's going to work? Is the heat going to creep up around the walls? Is the heat going to creep up in the middle? What's going to happen around the walls? Okay, we're up to 36. We'll get our answer in a second here. Okay, so let's take a look at this. I'll go back to my ISO surfaces. I'll just put that away for a second. Let me go through and edit this. And I'll start with a hot. So, oops, let me always go through and just change that to Fahrenheit just because that's a familiar unit to me. So the floor, remember, is 82 degrees. So not much more than that. Up there at the top of the heating, you sort of see a little heat there. It looks like you're in 85. Looks like inside the bottom of the wall, it's actually sort of getting a little warm there. Maybe it's storing the heat. 82, the floor is sort of at 82. It's interesting. It's kind of warm around the corners. Oh, actually, this is one. Did I mess up on this one? And you have the cold down there, cold coming in there. I think I've actually messed this one up because that's not doing what I would expect at all. I think that I have the wrong thing actually having the heat on it right now. So let's just go and think about this. Where this heat is being introduced right now, which is surface 141, let's see if I can figure this out. Let's go to a view. I want to figure out if the floor actually has this. My guess is that I don't have this on the right surface right now. Because on that surface right now, add to existing group. I gotta figure out which one it is. Let me go ahead and take it off there. I should be able to go through and say, let's grab the surface, edit that. Let's see if I can give it a temperature. Looks like it's surface 130, which is a little bit different. go ahead and say that it has the 3.5. That's just sort of related to how much heat flows past that. Give it a Fahrenheit. Okay, and then I'll say 82 in there. Okay, and we could run that again. But let's go ahead though and kind of think about how you could apply this to your own models if you want to. Because it works like this. If you want to, you can go through and you want to save your design study, I'll say no to that. You can look at some other models. There are some models that are sort of out there that are available. There's one that, for people who are looking at sort of big halls, I would recommend looking at this one. It's called Exhibit Hall. Exhibit Hall is like a large, you can think of it as an airport concourse or like some sort of convention center or something like that. This one's all about if you introduce air, how it mixes and it goes over and under. So if you're thinking about your atrium, this is a good one to look at. Okay, so we can start to sort of see things like that. But even better, let's just think about how you could actually do this with your Revit models. So the idea is I got a model. It's kind of hanging out right here. It's just waiting for me to do some sort of CFD analysis on it. And here's the way it works. If I go through and open, we could open up a model that I did just for this. I'll go to session 17. Actually, I have this. I don't. It's not out on your machines right now. Actually, maybe not. Where'd I hide it? Let me go out and I'll just do the one from, what was it? Do that one. Okay, here we have a nice Revit model. If you want to start doing CFD analysis on it, here's what you got to do. For the most part, we can take this model and send it over to CFD and start assigning materials to it. That actually works out pretty well. There's one variation to it, though, that you need to know about that just sort of helps out, and it has to do with all these doors and windows and stuff like that. Because CFD likes the notion that simple surfaces are just sort of like single surfaces that are easy to analyze. All these doors and windows right now are made up of a lot of different little pieces right there. So it doesn't quite like that in terms of taking it over to CFD. So the general principle is if you take your model and you say you want to go through and make it coarse, which generally shows a lot less detail in the materials, okay, and then even for this, come back in here, let me edit the family. You can actually choose if different pieces are available in different views. So for example, let's see if I can find it in here. It's the whole visibility part. So they've recently moved this, so I'll see if I can find it. It's under view. It's basically for each of these different elements, we can go through and control when it is visible and when it is not. There's these visibility settings, and you can basically say at what detail level each of these different parts would show. So for example, at the coarse level, if I don't want to show that little piece of frame, I could turn that off. Okay, if I don't want to show that piece over there, I can go through and turn that off. Okay, somewhere in here, even one of my view settings in here is preview visibility. Let's see what's going on. That should be coarse. I'm expecting those to go away right now. Oh, I'm doing it the exact opposite of what I need to do. What I want to do is turn it off on coarse. I'm wondering why that's like not working for me. Over here, in terms of the visibility over here, I would say that's not going to be on in coarse. Even this frame over here, I don't want that to be on in coarse. What's that thing there? That's my opening cut. I think I'm going to keep that. OK. Okay, so if I load this back into the project now, what's happening is I've replaced that compound window with just a single surface, which will make it a little bit easier for the analysis. Okay. So we'll do the same thing with the doors and the windows. So a little simplification makes your job over in CFD a whole lot easier. But once you've gone through and you've sort of simplified your little model and you're ready to go ahead and bring it over to CFD, what you do is as follows. You come on over and under Analyze, or actually under Add-ins, there's something that says launch the active model. And what that'll do is take this over to CD or CFD. And now we have basically that same model over here so we can start doing the analysis on it. Now, one of the few things you have to do over here, there's all sorts of different things you want to assign materials to it. It looks like actually maybe they're sort of paired across already in terms of what's going on. So what's happening is there's specific rules that are engaged. It looks like I picked up my last set of rules, so let's see what we're talking about that. You can set up different rules to auto-map things. For example, I had set up a rule that says, if the CAD object has the word window in it anywhere, go ahead and make the material glass. Okay. If the CAD object had anything that looked like floor in it, assign it to the material concrete. If the CAD object had footprint roof in it, it made it insulation. If it had the word walls in it, it also made it insulation. And if it just said volume, it made it air. And that's actually what it did. It went through and mapped all those things for me. So if you go through and set up the rules once, it becomes much easier to do, you know, what you need to do. So we can go through and kind of create all these different rules so that as you go and keep on updating your Revit model, it'll always keep on updating it over here. So with this, you're now ready to go through, and if you want to play with it, just assigning the boundary conditions. These are all the materials. If you want to start saying that there are some boundary conditions, you can choose that. Say that I want to put a boundary surface on that. So for example, if that has a temperature, okay, what you would do is, oops, that's the material editor. Boundary conditions, I can choose that. If you want to have a hot roof, go through, actually the one that's probably closer is if we do the whole thing where the film coefficient and we have a certain amount of BTUs per square foot moving past, and then we have a reference temperature, oh, if it's 90 degrees out or something like that. Okay. You basically have now a hot roof, and that'll start affecting what's going on inside. Okay, so CFD analysis, I just want to put it out there as something that you might want to consider using. Again, not everyone sort of needs it, but if you have a big open space and you're thinking about how air moves through it, it's a good tool to kind of think about using. Okay, but again, not required, but it's just kind of really cool to see what's happening. It sort of answers the question of how air actually moves through a space. Okay, let us go ahead. Any questions about that? It's really just more just kind of cool stuff I want you to know about before you kind of get out. Then, if not, let's go ahead and finish up today with a little bit of plumbing, because I think many of you are starting to work on your plumbing or starting to think about your plumbing. I know, Ms. Jacqueline, you're starting with your plumbing. Anyone else start with plumbing yet, or are you just getting going? Any other plumbers?
Still
not yet? No worries. Okay. Let's get you ready for plumbing, because that's actually sort of a good starting point. And to get you ready for plumbing, let's go over and, we'll open up a different example. We are going to, I think this is under, let's see if I can find it. It's still under 16. Let's say the plumbing examples. Take a look at that. We are going to start with this whole notion of some typical restrooms. And typical restrooms are just sort of a common layout. There's all sorts of different requirements. We talked about restrooms a little bit earlier, just in terms of the overall building layout. But let's kind of think about just what restrooms often look like. Very often we'll have a setup that looks something like this. In this case, what's happening is the restroom is sort of back to back, which has sort of an efficiency to it. Okay. You'll see I have all sorts of fixtures in here. I have some sinks, I have some urinals, I have some toilets. I also have some little separators. We call them bathroom partitions or toilet partitions. The way this is set up, there's one large stall, which is for ADA compliance. So a wheelchair could actually move on in. There's a possibility of a 5-foot circle in there. There's a lot of clear space in front here. You know, the basic dimensions are something like, let's see if I actually honored them in my little sample model. It's supposed to be approximately, well, it needs to be 5 feet. I shouldn't say approximately. That should be 5 feet. Looks like I'm shy right now. That's not good. Those should be about 3 feet. It's about 3'6". Well, I've got a problem in my restroom here. So even here, what I need to do is go ahead and make that 5 feet. I'll make that 3 feet. Maybe 3'3". Okay, that's a little bit better. So go ahead and pay attention to your dimensions in terms of all that, because some of those things are dictated by code and they have to be maintained that way. Other dimensions we have to watch out. This dimension from the wall to the front of it has to be at least 44 inches. Let's see how that is. Okay, 63, that's not too bad. Okay, other dimensions. We have to make sure that this dimension over here, I figured if that has to be 44 too, I believe it does. But I think we're in pretty good shape there. So this is looking pretty good. Some notes about the fixtures. You will note that the fixtures are a little bit different, because if you have put in a lot of fixtures which are considered to be architectural fixtures, they may not have all the attributes they need. Let's show you what I mean. Go back to the 3D view. Zoom on in here. Okay, you'll see I have some sinks. I have some other units in here. Let's take a look at this. This sink over here, if I click on it, notice has a number of different sort of outlets indicated. It has a 1/2 inch cold water in, has a 1/2 inch hot water in, has a 1.5 inch, it looks like, drain out. There's certain flow rates associated with all those things. This fixture is actually one that's considered to be a mechanical fixture, okay? There are also fixtures which don't have those attributes, and where you find all these and what you have to watch out for is if when you say load your families and you go to your plumbing fixtures, okay, you have the choice of architectural or mechanical. Most of the architectural ones, although they look perfectly good, go ahead and put one in here. I'll just drop it on the floor for now. Looks perfectly good, but the problem is it doesn't have any flow. It doesn't have any inlets or outlets. Okay? You need to add inlets and outlets or go through and use the mechanical ones. The ones in the mechanical folder already have the inlets and outlets. So if you come back over here and you say insert, and you load in plumbing fixtures, which are from the mechanical side, okay, these all have them. These are all wall mounted. So since I loaded that in, if I come now and I place that component, and I'm going to place it on a face, that's interesting. Let me place it the other way. I'm going to go through the systems, plumbing fixture. Still looks like it's going to do that in a funny way. Even that's kind of weird to me. It's kind of, oh, am I up too high? Yeah, I'm up way high. No, forget that. let's go back and show you that for these fixtures over here, each of them actually are the mechanical fixtures because they all have these flow units associated with them. Okay, so if you've put the wrong type of fixtures in it, not to worry. You just need to go through and kind of put equivalent mechanical ones in there instead. Okay, the other thing to watch out for relative to what we're going to do is you'll notice this bathroom has a nice little space between the walls. And what that's all about is just if we're going to run a lot of piping through here, it's often helpful to have a little mechanical chase, a place where you can run the drainage pipes, we can run the intake pipes, we can run them all through this little space between the two and hide everything back in the walls. Because the walls themselves may not be thick enough that you could actually sort of make all the pipe bends and curls and twists, okay, and actually have that in the room. So it's a very common condition. Next time you're actually in a sort of a big public restroom, check this out next time you're in a like airport restroom. Notice that often behind the toilets, there's this like shelf, and you might wonder what it's for. And it's not just there for the convenience of putting your briefcase up there temporarily and keeping things off the floor. It's actually a shelf that can be lifted up and service all the pipe that's underneath there, okay, without having to tear in the walls. So it's very common for us to go through and create something like this, just a nice little mechanical space between the different things. Okay? So that's the other thing you need to think about just architecturally in terms of laying them out. So at some level, it all starts just with laying all this out and kind of having the basic setup of like how the restroom could look. So let me pause there for a second and kind of see if most of that makes sense or if anyone has questions about the overall basic layout and the rules that kind of like dictate that. So. Anyone thinking about their restrooms? I think a lot of us have talked about your restrooms along the ways in terms of trying to think about the basic layout. But are there sort of interesting challenges or issues you're running into? No? What's that?
Typically, we're putting those plumbing fixtures in our architectural models. So we need to copy them into our mechanical.
Exactly. Exactly. You are 100% correct. You can put them in there too. Often the architectural model will want to have one just because the architect likes to see where the toilets are and all that kind of stuff. They like to see it on a plan. But you need a copy of it in your mechanical model so that you can use it as the basis for hooking up all the plumbing. Okay. So what that all means is I have this fantastic looking like a architectural plan model right now. Let me go ahead and close that up. And what we're going to do is, in the same sense that we did for structure and we did for the mechanical, or the HVAC system, we're going to create a new project. I'm going to create a mechanical template project. And the reason I want to create the mechanical template project is it has all the pipes and the elbows and the bends and all the connections that we need to kind of tie it all together. If we don't, then we're going to sort of just run into problems where when we try to connect things together, it won't know how to route because it doesn't have all the necessary pieces. So we'll go through and do a little insert. I'll get those typical restrooms. Is that the one I used? I'll pull that in. I'll say origin to origin. Do a little upgrading in the background. But it's going to go through and create a link to the file. And what we're going to do is copy out the plumbing fixtures. Okay, so I'm looking at my mechanical plan here. Here we can see all those plumbing fixtures. Now, although those plumbing fixtures sure look good, they're actually the ones that are back over in the Revit model. Okay, so I can go through and select them. Okay, but even though I'm selecting them, notice that it's not giving me the information about the connections and all that kind of stuff. So what I have to do is, kind of like we did before, we're going to collaborate and say, let's copy monitor them in from the link project. Okay. And now we're going to go out and grab them. So I'm going to go through and copy that sink in. It's doing a little thinking right now. Okay, very unexciting. It's gonna, oops, it's gonna just copy a wall in there. Copy that sink in. Copy that in. Copy the toilet in. Copy that toilet in. Okay, when I finish, what's gonna happen is now these have all the inputs on them. Okay, so always go ahead and copy them in because the copy monitor, if your architect moves the toilet around, you'll still keep up with it. Okay, you now have a bunch of fixtures. You're in such good shape, you're ready to start piping. Okay, so let's think about this. I'm only gonna sort of handle, I guess, the men's room now. I'm gonna handle the women's room in just a little bit. As we think about it, there's gonna be three main piping systems in a typical one, a couple, five, if we actually kind of try to be a little bit more sustainable. But in a typical restroom, we'll have hot water, cold water, and sanitary, kind of carrying out. Hot water only needs to apply to the lavatories, wash your hands. The cold water goes to all the fixtures, and sanitary goes to all the different fixtures. Okay, so that's a typical setup. If we want to be a little bit creative and try to be sustainable and recycle some water, we can change that around a little bit. We will say that, hey, you know, that water coming off of the sinks could actually be recycled. So we'll, instead of draining it out to the sewer, we'll drain it to some sort of recycling system. And then we'll go back and pipe it back in. So instead of feeding cold water to the toilets and the urinals, we'll bring the recycled water in there. Okay, so, but that's a variation. We'll plumb it the standard way first, and then we can sort of change it to go through and match the other system. So how it generally works is this. What I almost always do is I'll run the main branch lines in, sort of the trunks of the tree, the lines where you're pretty certain where you want it to be, and you're very confident about that location because it makes sense in your overall plan, and then connect the fixtures into it. Okay, and that almost always works. It's like running the main duct lines and connecting things into it. But if you have a pretty good sense of where things are going to be, go through and just start with that. So what that would look like, for example, is if I go to my floor plan and zoom on in here, I know that somehow running right through that central wall right there, I'm going to go through and put in some sort of hot water line. And to do that, what I'm going to do is go to systems. I'm going to say I'm going to create some sort of pipe. We get to sort of say what's the diameter of the pipe and what the type is. For the type, I'll choose, domestic hot water. For the size of that, it's probably copper, but 6 inches is so big. We don't need that big a pipe. We could probably get by with, like an inch pipe, maybe an inch and a half pipe. It's really not going to be nearly as big as that. Okay, we also choose the height off of the floor. And for right now, I just need to have some sort of height. I'll say maybe it's 6 feet. I'm going to try and keep things at different heights so they can cross past each other without interfering. So we'll do that. In terms of this, is this a slope? No, this one doesn't have any slope. For the cold water and the hot water, we don't need to provide any slope. They're pressurized, so they can just run really at any angle. They don't need to have a slope on them. So I'll come through and from this area, just run a nice pipe. Coming on back through here. Take that pipe over there. Now it's complaining a little bit. It's complaining that things aren't available in this view. Let me kind of take a look and see why. It's here. I can go ahead and make that finer and sort of see it. I think the problem is that it's just above the cut plane right now. So if I go back to the floor plan, I know what it is. I'm looking at the mechanical floor plan. Let me go to the plumbing plan. Okay, you'll see there it is. And if you want to, you can make it a finer resolution, which will then show the pipe in its all its glory. Okay, so I have a nice cold hot water pipe in there. Let's go ahead and put a cold water pipe in right next to it. Again, it's gonna be 1 inch. It's gonna go though domestic cold water. And then I'll just give it a slightly different height, maybe 5 feet. This I'm going to run the entire distance. It's actually kind of right underneath the other one right now, which may or may not be good. I'm going to shove it over just by using the arrow so we can see the difference. Okay, the last major trunk line I'm going to want in here is the sanitary line. And this is the only one you have to be careful about, because the sanitary line has to have that little bit of slope. So you're going to start running it either from the highest point and take it to the lowest point, or vice versa. You just have to tell it which way. Okay, so what I'm going to do is go over to my piping, say, hey, let's go ahead and choose that it wants to be a sanitary pipe. Okay, it won't be copper. What will that one be? Generally using copper. Those tend to be bigger, but for now, leave that and just make it, like a 4-inch pipe. Okay, super. As we're going to go through and place it, a couple different things to think about. One is the height. So as you think about the height, they tend to run pretty low. They're down near the ground or even under the ground, okay? Because we have to think about the height of this and the height of that one, and we're sort of sloping a quarter inch equals a foot. So we could try to run it up above the ground, but what happens most typically in a building like this is actually my drain pipe is actually in the ceiling of the floor below me. It all comes down. So a lot of the pipes that you see are not servicing this floor. They're actually servicing the floor above us. So what I'm going to do is, in that same sense, I'm going to say, hey, you know, this pipe is going to be actually minus 6 inches or something like that, just to kind of run it below. I'm going to give it a little slope. It's going to slope down. That is from the starting point to the end. And I can choose a dimension. It's a quarter inch equals a foot. That's our standard slope. As we, for every foot, we have to slope it a quarter inch to keep all the sewage moving downhill. So I can say, let's run it here, run it back over to here. Okay, it's going to again warn us that things aren't visible. That's just because since it's under the floor, we're not seeing it right now. But if I look at it in 3D, you'll see it's there. And let's just pop that up. Same sense. Make that fine. Now, you may be wondering about these pipes and where they're going. And where they're going is back over to some sort of central room where we probably have a vertical pipe that's going to go right up and down through the building, connecting all the different levels to sort of branch off to all these other individual terminuses. So over there, if we were going to go through and look at this in, for example, an elevation view, which would be the easiest way to run this, let me go ahead and do that. I'll give myself a nice elevation. I think some of us were playing around with this when we were trying to place things in your models. Often a section does you a world of good in terms of placing things, because in that section view, I can see those pipes very nicely. And now I can go through and run a vertical pipe that goes through them. So for example, I could say, let's go ahead and systems, put that pipe in there. Oh, we'll go through and do the domestic cold water first. It's going to be the 1-inch pipe. Might be an inch and a half by the time we get done here. I'll bring that on down. Same thing for the hot water. I'll run a pipe for that. Even the sanitary system. The sanitary system, what I'll do is, again, bring something like that in there. Give that the 4 inches. and bring that on down. Now, if you have a multi-story building, which a lot of us do, you might not just bring it down as an elbow, you might actually bring that up as a riser and connect that in with a T instead of some type. Okay, so that's okay too. Looks like my green and my reds are intersecting a little. I need to move that over a little bit because I don't want that to happen. Maybe if I go to the Fleming plan view, where is my green and my red? Maybe I'll pull that out just a little further this way. But it's hard to get everything not to cross. Looks like it's barely nicking it. Okay, once you have these main lines run, you are now ready to go through and connect it all together. So here are the rules for connecting it together. If you have an open end, it'll try to connect to the open end before it ties a T into something. So if you don't want it to try to connect the hot water to the open end, the best strategy typically is to choose that and say cap the open end. Okay, that puts a little cap on it, kind of like the ductwork. Same sort of thing happens with the blue cold water. I'm going to cap the open end. Even for my sanitary over here, I'm going to cap the open end on that one. That's just so that, as opposed to it always try to go the way of least resistance. So if it finds an open end, it'll try to go to that. If you cap it, then it'll say, oh, okay, well then if I can't find an open end, I'll T into it, and I'll just do it in the closest way I can. So we are ready to now connect some fixtures. And when we want to connect some fixtures, we choose the fixture, we say connect into, and then we choose, based on the system, what pipe it'll go to. So for the sink, for example, I'll say let's connect into. I'll take cold water first, and connect it to cold. I'll take this, I'll say connect into, and do the hot. Not too bad. And then I'll say take that and connect into the sanitary. Now, we can play around a little bit. We'll play around next time with it. If you don't want the sink pipe running straight down, we could actually run the pipe up and connect over to it. Because that's a little ugly right now. But it's functionally correct, even if it's not so great looking. Again, we'll connect into the cold, we'll go to cold. The hot will go to hot. Oops, hang on. Is that saying there's not enough room? It's like chose the wrong end of the pipe. Let me connect into, I'll choose this pipe. You might wonder why when we get to the sanitary, it doesn't ask me. And the reason is because we've already connected everything else. There's nothing left. So connecting that. Okay. Finally, just to finish this off, and this is where we'll finish today. If you want to get the urinal, it'll go up to cold. Again, not probably the way the connection is actually going to happen, but we'll play with that next time and take it down to the drain pipe. Even our ever popular toilet connects up and connects down. So hopefully you're getting a sense that this really isn't too bad. If you get the fixtures in the right places and you get the trunk lines in the right places, after that, it's pretty much just these little small scale connect into, connect into, connect into. And let us go ahead and just kind of stop there for today in terms of doing this. That'll hopefully be enough to get you started. If you already have your model and you've already put in some toilets in one of the models, the idea of kind of copying them into the mechanical model is not so bad. But your first step is really just going through and figuring out where the blue and the red, the hot and the cold, are going to be, and the main sanitary line and where that's going to come down. And after you get those in place, connecting in the individual units is not so bad. Okay, so let us pause for today and pick up next time. There should be, if there aren't already, some office hours kind of hanging around. Usually, well, both Alana and Angad both do it. So take a look for those, see if they are. If they aren't, they should show up. Also, tomorrow afternoon, like from 12 on, and like Friday, generally, I just tend to live down in 184. So you can come on down there and find us, and we'll kind of help you out with anything that's coming up. But go ahead and sign on up, and let's get you some guidance going. And just really this week, we'll try and figure out, you know, how you're going to wrap this up and sort of finish in the next couple weeks, so that you can get the most out of your models without making it an overwhelming task. Okay, super. Let us adjourn.